for the students, this is a sound check, this is a sound check. roundabout.
Meditative concentration chart, page 79. So there, this is a section on exchanging self for other. So I think many of the Tonglen practice will come from there. I will leave my happiness behind and embrace the pain of others. Take the blame of others' faults and openly admit even my minor faults. By praising others, I will make their fame outshine my own and always serve them. Hiding any qualities that I might have, so no one knows them. I think you find that also in the 8th verse of thought training. You know, it's a little bit similar. Holding other more dear than oneself. So basically, you know, cherish other more than oneself. This is often some people in the West misunderstand that. I think that we have to consider oneself rubbish and the other ones as precious. It doesn't mean that. So you see, if you deep down in your heart care for others and cherish them, in your heart, there's a great wealth. There's a lot of, how to say, there's light, there's love, there's a notion of bliss inside your heart. It's very comfortable, you know. So, how to say, you hold that more dear than you, and you praise them, you cherish them. But deep in your heart, you're very comfortable, very happy. It's not at all a distressed state of mind. It's not at all you feel miserable or, you know, you feel lonely. Not at all. It's like, you know, the mind of love and compassion, of cherishing others. How to say? That humble attitude is very comfortable. It's very nice. And you feel very much at peace. You know, in your heart, there's a lot of peace. So often one doesn't realize, you see, one just sees the outer form. So when I say, when it says, I will leave my happiness behind and embrace the pain of others, it means that, you see, mentally, instead of thinking about me, my happiness, what can make me happy, you go into this mood of compassion, of caring for others. And actually, that state of mind of caring for others is happier than thinking, me, how can I make myself happy? See, there is peace in that state of mind. And then take the blame of others' fault and openly admit even my minor fault. This again, you see the ego doesn't like that, right? So it doesn't take on the blame of others and doesn't like to admit one's mistake. But the true self, or let's say the maybe label I, he likes it very much. He doesn't mind at all. And in that attitude is great peace. Because how to say, the I that exists has nothing to lose. You see, praise doesn't make it better, and blame doesn't make it worse. Again, getting something doesn't make your true self or the meditative life happy. And not gaining something doesn't make him unhappy. Your true nature is not affected by praise, blame, gain, loss, fame, criticism. So your true nature is not affected by that at all. The ego is affected. By praising others, I will make their fame outshine my own. And always serve them, hiding any quality I might have, so no one knows about them. So that's not very good if you want to apply for a job. Gonna run into trouble. But for peace of mind, you know, for practitioners, this is a very, very nice advice. And it's really, if you try for a few, you know, you try once to do that, you will see there's a lot of peace in your heart, there's a lot of joy in that attitude. The ego, not happy, you know, but the true self, meditative life, very happy. In brief, may all the harm I have done to others come back to me. You see, it will come back anyway. So here you accept it willingly. in the Lojong, in the Tonglen, normally the way it's done, I haven't done it here because many people get uncomfortable about that. There's a lot of people that get very uncomfortable. You know, when you take away the suffering of others, normally, like His Holiness Dalai Lama explains, you inhale that suffering of other and you use it to destroy your selfish mind in your heart. So you put it onto, see, you put it onto the culprit, which is your selfish mind. So imagine the suffering of other, or in this case, your own negative karma coming back and destroying its cause, which is your selfish mind. See, so you imagine kind of a shell of your selfish mind as something concrete, a rock in your heart, or a shell, you know, yeah, a kind of shell around your heart, around your pure nature. And then the suffering of your own negative karma, the suffering of, you take it in to destroy this shell of selfishness. And so, you know, by destroying your selfishness, then what is left is your pure mind, you know, your pure altruistic state of mind. So you use the suffering to destroy your selfish mind. But many people in the West are very uncomfortable with that. Some people think, if I take on the suffering of others like that, I will get sick. Many people, yeah, feel uncomfortable with that. I get sick. I take the cancer of other on me, I will get cancer. You know? So if I take someone else's cold on me, I will get cold. Or if I take someone else's mental affliction, I will get his or her mental affliction. So some people think like that. And even some psychic, you know, some student that was psychic, you know, they really think that they take upon them, you know, the suffering of other, or, you know, their physical and mental thing. You know, for example, you have these people which make massage or Reiki massage and things like that, and then after one day, you know, they put the energy away because they think, you know, they've taken upon themselves, they pay, you know, whatever they took away from the subtle energy of the person. So this type of people are very uncomfortable with this kind of meditation where you actually take on the suffering of other. Yeah. So that's why usually I just say, you know, you take it away from people and then dissolves into space, you know. So in terms of compassion, it also works that way. But usually His Holiness Dalai Lama explained and the lineage lamas that actually you're supposed to bring it to your heart, you know, to harm your selfish mind. So, but, you know, whichever way feels comfortable for you. Because the idea from lamas like His Holiness is that actually, you see, the pain, you use it to destroy its cause, the cause being the selfish mind. So it has to hurt the selfish mind. And then if it actually implies to experience some, you see, if, from a Buddhist point of view, if you don't have the karma, you cannot experience the pain, right? So just visualize taking on the pain of others, it doesn't make you able to transfer that other people's suffering onto you. If you haven't created a cause for something, you cannot experience it. So it's not possible to imagination to take on other people's pain. Even though they are exceptions. You see, so if you have a very strong kind of connection with someone, you know, then sometimes it's possible. So if you have a close karma with someone, then it's possible. You know, there are examples of yogis that can take on the suffering of others. So, but for us ordinary being, usually depends on karma. There's a purpose, you see, if you inhale and suffer. For example, like it says here, so you take your future suffering, so you inhale your future suffering that you're going to experience anyway. So you inhale it and you put the blame onto what causes that suffering, which is our own negative actions or lack of selfishness. So you use the pain, see, to say, look, that's your fault. You know, you speak to the ego, the dominant eye in the existent eyes. Look, that's your fault why I suffer. So you use it to destroy him. You put the blame on him. So that's the idea of that visualization. But yeah. I think one has to do whatever one feels comfortable. I think it also works just to take the pain of atom and dissolve it into space. The important is to induce compassion and love. In brief, may all the harm I have done to others come back to me. May I be free of arrogance and act as shy as a young bride. So a young bride, I think, not necessarily shy anyway. That's like in Indian culture, you know. From now on, I will be thought on you, O mind, and you will abandon your selfish ways. You, the cause of all my suffering, wherever you go, I will destroy your arrogance. I have offered you to others, so be of service. So, you see, these kind of words are scary to the ego. He doesn't like them at all. He likes to, what's next? Let's turn the page. But sometimes with meditation, in meditation it's good to try to feel that, you know, what kind of state of mind arises if you do that. And then you notice there's a lot of peace there. It's not at all that you feel distressed, unhappy. In your heart there's peace. You see, like I said before, your pure mind has nothing to lose. It's just an ocean of light, an ocean of love, an ocean of bliss. So it doesn't have anything to lose. So it's happy to, you know, to serve Radha, he's happy to be there for Radha. It's the ego mind, you know, the selfish mind, he's not happy with that. So the bodhisattvas, that's how they live, you see, there's this ocean of love, of bliss, of light in their heart, and that's what they identify with. So and then the more they love, the more they serve, the more bliss and the more joy is in their heart. So it actually feeds the inner bliss to serve Adam, to help. So, you know, they're always ready to help in a new way, you know. They're very happy. Because for them it's not at all a pain or an obstacle to their own happiness. It actually feeds their happiness. So this verse can be misunderstood. If I don't give you to other, without a doubt you will lead me to hell. How many times have you brought me there? Remembering your selfishness, I will subdue you. So here he speaks to the ego mind, to the selfish mind. You know, if we follow the selfish mind, definitely, you know, we create out of greed and aversion, we create negative karma. Then this negative karma and this mental affliction will lead us to lower rebirth. If I want happiness, I should cherish Adam. If I want protection, I should protect others. So you see, a person that cherishes others, that loves others, that cares for others, that serves others, that person has many friends. You know, everybody likes such a person. So relatively that, and then you see, if you cherish other, you will only create good karma, then that comes back as happiness in your mind. So physically you're happy because other people, you know, like you back, things like that. And then mentally you're happy because you don't create any negative karma, so your mind is at peace. If I want protection, I should protect others. So same thing, the karma comes back. See, if you protect Adam, half of Adam, you don't need to worry. It's very interesting if you check bodhisattvas. If you check many Tibetans, bodhisattvas, you know, they came this life in very poor families, and then they grew up in Tibetan monasteries, so very poor, things like that. And then later on, you know, many of these beings, you know, they do well in life. So because of their love, their compassion, their bodhicitta, it attracts. That attracts positive things. The more I pamper this body, the more temperamental it becomes. And the more temperamental, the more I crave to satisfy it, but to no avail. This craving is misery. Those who are free from it find everlasting peace. So I won't let my physical desire increase, and I will surround myself with things that don't arouse desire. Sometimes a little bit in the West we get obsessed, you know, with this body, with health, and let alone its appearance. You know, kind of, so we get kind of, because of our society, we become very self-conscious and of our appearance. And so to keep the body healthy, that's good, but when it becomes an obsession, because one thing for sure, no matter what you do with your body, it's going to grow old, decay and die, you know. No matter how you take care of it, it's a downhill battle and you're not going to win. That's why it's more important to take care of the mind. So to keep the body healthy, you know, with food, some exercise, that's very good, but then some people make it really over the top. It becomes a fashion statement, or it becomes You see, some people don't know anything better. I think a healthy body, that's all there is in life. But in spiritual practice, you're more concerned with having a healthy mind. Because the healthy mind, that's what you take with you when you die. That's your healthy body, you don't take with you when you die. And then surrounding myself with things that don't arouse desire, this is very good for the peace of mind. You know, if you have things that are too valuable around you, you're always afraid that they get broken or that they, you know, something happens to them or they get stolen and so forth. If things, have things around that are not too valuable to you, you don't mind, you know, they break, okay, I can replace it. So for the peace of mind, it's much easier. So when he says, you know, things that don't arouse desire, it doesn't mean that they have to be dirty and not clean and, you know, not to take care of things. It doesn't mean that. It just means that their value is not that great. It's just in context of keeping peace of mind. Why get attached to this impure body, which will end up in ashes, as ashes? What use is this machine to me, alive or dead? Oh, feeling of I, why don't you die? Attachment to my body has only brought me pain. Why care for its loves and hates? This body doesn't care about its own fate, so why should I protect it? Nor does it know anger or pleasure, so why exhaust myself on its behalf? So So here Shantideva speaks from the point of view of the mind and looks at the body as a little bit a separate thing. So yeah, the body doesn't care about all these things, so why me, the mind, should care so much about the body? I like my body. It and I are friends. Well, since all beings like their bodies, why don't I find pleasure in theirs? I will give up this body for the sake of others and look after it like I would a tool. Enough of my childish ways. I will follow the wise and avoid sleep and laziness. If I don't make constant effort day and night, when will my suffering come to an end? To eliminate delusion, I will constantly rest my mind with meditative concentration on the perfect object emptiness. So I think I like to read this section on bodhicitta, you see, in this 8th chapter. It's actually in meditation, it's very, very helpful to get some inner peace and to see how bodhisattvas, you know, we aspire to become bodhisattvas, so that's how bodhisattva, you know, practice or looks at things. The thing is that if we do it, you see, meditation, you see, there's peace in the heart, in that letting go of the self-centered attitude and care for other instead. There's peace. Maybe for 10 minutes, try to, you know, think about a few of those verses and see how it feels in your heart. And if you can let go of our self-centered attitude and really imagine that you care for others. And then you care for others without expecting anything in return. You don't expect thanks. You don't expect praise. You don't expect a good reputation. You're simply loving and caring for the sake of it, without something back. freely without anything wanting back. So it's like you have the sun in your heart, very soft, honey-like, very warm, blissful, and it radiates from your heart in all directions. It's there to make other people happy, to serve others. He doesn't want anything himself or herself. It's simply happy to be love, to be compassion. As a mere designation by the mind of this loving mind. So there's no I within that loving mind. I is merely labeled on that loving mind. is also senseless. So it's not a solid loving mind. It's almost like you look at a cloud from far away. It looks a cloud there. But when you, with the plane, you go inside the cloud, there's no cloud, there's only fog. So there appears to be a loving mind there. But if you zoom in with your mind, it's just space, space of awareness. So loving mind is mainly labeled by the mind on that space of awareness that is colored with love, compassion. There's no solid loving mind. Spread your love, your compassion, the more you radiate it from your heart, the more blissful, the more peaceful your heart mind becomes. Sense of I, due to habit, solidifies itself again and again, and the space of loving mind also solidifies itself. So you have to undo that solidity again and again. See that this loving mind is not you. You is made a label onto that loving mind. The loving mind is merely labeled the space of awareness that's colored by love. So they're not solid, tangible thing. They're dependent arising. Then your sense of I becomes dreamlike, and love becomes dreamlike, or rainbow-like. Slowly, positive energy, watching it by contemplating Shantideva's practice of exchanging self-order. May our true heart of love and compassion ceaselessly grow. See, like in praise of Lama Tsongkhapa says, Avalokiteshvara, treasure of objectless compassion or aimless compassion. See, to have a heart that loves and has compassion freely, just for the sake of love and compassion, without any aim, loves everyone without any expectation. So whatever love and compassion we already have developed, may that never decrease, but increase more and more day by day. And may whatever love and compassion we have not yet generated be generated and also increase forevermore. So the love and compassion of a bodhisattva continue to increase in scope and in intensity until he is Buddha. So it's not that we generate bodhicitta and then it stays the same. Our love and compassion will continue to grow day by day, month by month, year by year, lifetime by lifetime, until we completely omniscient. Till our heart mind pervades all that exists. Soon to have this exalted experience of being our heart, mind, pervade all that exists, and then spontaneously manifest in any way that benefits others. Without effort, without need to think, spontaneously manifest effortlessly.
Schedule in the Zen Garden on the announcement board again for the transportation at the end of the retreat. If you need a pickup, so if you can put your name, because then we're gonna start slowly to arrange who can bring back people maybe to the train station or to the airport or something. And some of you also go back to Toulouse, can bring someone also, so you can write your things. Another thing is from this afternoon onward, I will put some envelope on the table there, and then it will be for the one who wants. If you you want to make a little offering to Venerable Bonne, for the type of a little card or so. You know, Gendun is drawing something, he's a very good artist. And also for the volunteers and also for the translators, if you want to make a little offering. What else? Yeah, someone found an earring, and we don't know who it is, and bring it to the basic program board. If you are that person, please can you come to me, because there's still something missing of that earring, so we'd like to know where you found it, actually, to search. Maybe if it's not someone here, then maybe it's a volunteer. Something else I don't remember. Sorry.
Okay.
Bon appétit.